done 10 minutes quicker.
Well, good morning. God is great. All the time.
Welcome to First United Methodist Church, to all who are worshiping on site and to those who are worshiping online with us today. Our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Our vision is believing, belonging, and becoming. We welcome in worship leadership today, Reverend Alan Davis, and our accompanist, Deneen Owens. And we want to be food for the hungry and living water for the thirsty. This is a safe place for all ages to worship, to learn, to grow, and to become faithful disciples of Jesus. And to all children, we celebrate your smiles, your energy, your wiggles, and your giggles. Welcome to all who are here today. Let's worship and praise God together.
And of course, as always, we have plenty of announcements. So we'll start off with tonight at the Outreach Center for our Ignite service at 6 o'clock. We'll be continuing our Messages That Matter, and we'll be talking about standing firm. Also, Wednesday, I guess I'll steal a little of your thunder, but on Wednesday is Summer Splash, and there will be the Pawnee Plunge this week.
Yes,
so some fun times for the youth.
Pawnee Plunge, and I've got to double check the times, but we usually start a little bit earlier than 6:30. So I'll send out a message to everyone. So be watching for messages about the splash for this week.
Also, you'll notice that out on the trees, the Christmas trees, it's Christmas in July. And so the mission committee, you can simply go out and pick up a star. The mission committee is supporting Camp Fontenelle. And also, I have to remember, I just drew a blank. Camp Fontenelle, it'll come to me in just a minute. Habitat for Humanity. See, give me time. It's still early in the morning. So basically, you don't have to worry. Last year, it was like, well, do I pick this up because it's tape measures or brushes or whatever. This time, it's simply a gift card. And that it goes to either Camp Fontenelle or Habitat for Humanity. Got it.
Very nice. And our flowers today are in memory of Bill and Margaret Knoll's 70th anniversary, which would have been on July 13th. And it's given by Suzanne and Tracy, their daughters.
Yes. Are there other announcements that should come forward? No? Yes. Okay, very good. Thank you.
Thanks for Dean. Chuck.
Other announcements? Anything?
I can't think of anything. My brain's too full. I'm too tired.
too full of things to do.
And I'm very tired.
All right,
today.
So let's begin with our call to worship. Inspired by Psalm 82. God takes a stand in the divine council. Give justice to the lowly and the orphan. Uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed. Rescue the weak and the needy. Deliver them.
Rise up, O God.
Judge the earth, for all the nations are your inheritance. Now join us in our opening hymn, Open My Eyes That I May See.
Thank you.
now let us sing our song as we invite those who are young at heart to come forward.
Good morning. So Pastor Cindy asked me to do children's time today, and she left me a bag. And it's pretty heavy. It's pretty heavy. Let's see what's in it. Oh, my goodness. It's a brick. It was heavy. It was heavy. It's a brick. Wow. Let's see. I got a couple things that come to mind about this brick. One, we have our mission trip coming up, and I'll be talking about that here in a second. But our scripture today actually talks about sin. And, you know, sometimes sin can weigh us down. Okay, sin does weigh us down. And when I picked up the bag, I wasn't expecting it to be as heavy as it was. But now I took the brick out of the bag, and the bag is really light. So I guess thinking about this brick in this bag, it makes me think about our sin and how if you think about each and every sin and you think of it as a brick and you were carrying a backpack and you were to put your sins in the backpack, how much would it weigh you down? And what would it take for you to let them go? Think about what it would take for you to release those, to let go of that weight upon yourself. I think I want to let go of bricks. They're kind of heavy. Will you pray with me? This is repeat after me prayer. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the opportunity.
For the opportunity.
To let go of our sins.
To let go of our sins.
To release them to you. And know that you take them.
And know that you take them.
Far away from us.
Far away from us.
Never to return.
Never to return.
And so, Lord.
And so, Lord.
I give to you.
I give to you.
All my sins.
All my sins.
Release them from me.
Release them from me.
Amen. All right, so now I'm going to tell you a little bit about our mission trip. So next Saturday, we're meeting here at the church, the mission team. We're meeting here at the church, and we're going to load up, and we're going to head to Omaha and jump on an airplane, and we're going to flap our wings and fly to Seattle. And then from Seattle, we're flying to Anchorage, Alaska. And then we get in a vehicle, and we drive about an hour to an hour and a half to Palmer, Alaska. And there's a very interesting story how we're going to Alaska. So our seniors get to pick where we go, within reason. And about every third year or so, we let the senior pick a bigger trip. And so we have two seniors this year on our trip. We have Kyson and Micaiah. And Micaiah wanted to go to Guatemala, and Kyson wanted to not go to Guatemala because Kyson said, I'm sick and tired of sweating. And so he said, I want to go somewhere where it's cold. So we ended up in Alaska. So I started researching, and we usually go with Next Step Ministries. That's our favorite organization to work with. And we go to Fairbanks. They were full. They had no openings. So I had to do a little more research and came up with an organization that we went with when we went to Puerto Rico. And they put me in touch with a man by the name of James. He's with Mazatlan Missions. And he was telling me about this place in Palmer, Alaska. It's called the 98 Fund. The 98 Fund was started by the class of 1998 from West Point. And it was started by a few of the men that were in that class. And they wanted to do something for the families of their fallen comrades. They had quite a few who died in Afghanistan, Iraq, Kosovo, Bosnia, and many other places, and they wanted to do something for the families of their fallen. So they bought a parcel of land in Palmer, Alaska, and they are currently building a retreat center for the families of the fallen to come. And while they're there, they get to do a project together, they get to do activities together, and they get to process, heal, grieve, and remember. So what we are going to do, our mission team, we are going to Palmer, Alaska, to the 98 Fund, and we are going to help build cabins for the families to stay in when they come. When James was telling me about this, I had goosebumps. I've actually got goosebumps right now, just telling you about this. I'm so super excited for this. One of the activities we get to do is we get to climb Gold Star Peak, and at the top of Gold Star Peak is a tower, and we get to add dog tags to the of fallen men, servicemen and women, to the tower, and we get to look at the names of the fallen, and we get to take rocks of our own family members who have fallen. So my husband's uncle died in Vietnam, so we are taking a rock that has his name on it, and we're going to be placing it on the grounds of the 98 Fund. I'm going to just ask that you be in prayer for us. This is a huge undertaking that we're doing. We're all super excited, super stoked for what we're going to do. But there's a lot of anxiety in place with this, with travel, airlines, people not showing up to fly the planes, planes getting delayed, just lots of different things. So I'm just going to ask that you be in prayer for us. We have 19 people going on this mission trip, 13 kids and 6 adults. Two kids and two of the chaperones are not members of this church. And one of the other chaperones is Connie Kramer, and she's the lay leader minister for Monroe, Silver Creek, and Genoa. She's going with us as a chaperone. So I'm just going to ask that you be in prayer. Daniel, my son, is actually up top, and so he and I are the only ones that are here for the 8 o'clock service. But I'm going to just ask that you raise your hand and extend it, and we're going to just pray for all of the people going on our trip, and even for those who are in Alaska right now preparing for us to show up. So will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity for our youth mission team to go do this service work. I pray for each individual that you would just quell their anxiety, their fears, their questions, that peace would just descend upon each and every person. I pray for safety in travel and for travel mercies, that there would be no delays in our travels. I pray for safety in our work, safety in our fun, safety in our activities. And Lord, I pray for the body, mind, and spirit of each and every person that goes. May we be open to your Holy Spirit and everything that you would have for us to learn and to do while we are there. And may we bring back your glory and your praise and share it with each and every person here. In your very precious name, amen.
And one other thing, Sarah, right after the benediction.
Right after the benediction, if you would just stay where you are, right after the benediction, there's going to be a video that's going to play that kind of gives you an idea of where we're going and what we're doing. It's like a 4-minute video. So if you wouldn't mind just staying and watching that little video after the service.
And it is indeed a really cool video. I've seen it. Let's join together and prepare ourselves with our song of prayer, number 2150.
Thank you.
we come together in our time of prayer, let's open this up to for our joys and concerns. And obviously, we had a great start with Chuck and their son Dean. Hopefully, the prayers for him. Other joys or concerns that we can bring to God today. We certainly celebrate as we move forward and as the youth mission prepares to go. We also keep our thoughts and our prayers for Reverend Cindy and Clint and the entire Stewart family as they celebrated a new addition to their family with a new son-in-law. So their wedding was yesterday, and so we celebrate and offer our prayers up for them and for Izza and Ryan for a long and happy life. Other joys. Oh, very good. So Deneen and Tim celebrating their anniversary, was it last Thursday?
This coming Thursday.
All right, so congratulations to them. And I have to say this now because it'll be on video and my wife will check. Next Saturday is my wife's and my anniversary, so I have to have a record that I did that. All right. Other joys or concerns? We know that things are not always as we'd like them to be. The world is a dark place at times. We find things hard to understand and hard to comprehend across the world. Hunger and anger and frustrations and violence. So let's keep all those people that are suffering with illnesses, those who are in the hospital, those under hospice care, those who have suffered through violence. We certainly keep the people of Ukraine in our prayers. And we keep all of those. And we keep those in our prayers for those that keep us safe on a daily basis. The police and the fire and the rescue personnel, all the people that are there, our military, that work day by day to keep us safe. And then let's also, as always, keep our prayers up for our leaders, that they can make wise decisions for us all. Are there others? Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord God, Almighty God, we come to you today. We praise you that we can indeed come here and that we can offer ourselves to you. Lord God, that we can accept the salvation you give and that we can bask in the joy of accepting that. Lord God, we come to you though as those that still are at fault. We still make our mistakes. Lord God, we ask you to forgive us for those. Lord God, we praise you and are so thankful for your mighty power and your mighty love and your grace. Lord God, we offer up in joys birthdays and weddings and anniversaries and healings. And Lord God, we come to you asking that you wrap your loving arms around those who are suffering today, whether it be through loneliness, hunger, violence. Lord God, we ask that your presence be among them and on their hearts. Lord God, we know that you are the one true God. And Lord God, we ask all of these things in the name of your Son who taught us all to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God calls on us to engage in ministry and mission. We celebrate each and every opportunity in this church to celebrate our connection in the United Methodist and to make a difference in all the ways that are possible through our tithes and our offerings. God has offered us so much and asks so little. In that spirit, we invite our ushers forward to receive our gifts today. Almighty God, giver of every good and perfect gift, teach us to render to you all that we are and all that we have, that we may praise you with our whole lives. Amen. Please remain standing as you are able for the reading of the gospel.
This morning's scripture lesson is written in the second chapter of Ephesians, beginning at the first verse. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. As God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. May God add a blessing to the hearing and understanding of this word.
Now it's my pleasure to invite forward Reverend Alan Davis.
Please be seated. And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. I would like to begin my sermon this morning by showing you a little video about a minute long. And after the minute video, for those of you that know my father, the question will be, which one of us is crazier, him or me? Got the video? Can we have it, Daniel? Maybe not. Well, maybe I'm crazy for trying to have a video this morning. Oh, here we go. Can we have the volume?
There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky. Got the sun in my eyes. And I won't be surprised if it's a dream. I'm on the top of the world. This is the end, beautiful friend. This is the end, my only friend. The end of our elaborate plans. The end.
I think you get the gist of it now. You want to cut that for me, Daniel? So which one is crazier, my dad or me? No, we won't go into that. So I want to begin this morning with that video because it seems interesting to me that many of us are trapped in sin. That's what this passage says. This passage says that states that we are dead in our trespasses and our sins. In other words, we are trapped in our sin. We are caught in the mousetrap of sin. And sin can control our lives and can separate us from God. Now, Paul, throughout his scripture, throughout his writings, tries to define for us what sin is. I would like to expound on the idea of what sin is by telling you that sin is anything that separates you from God. Sin can literally be anything that separates you from God, anything that you place before God, anything that is more important to you than God. And so sin, the definition of sin broadens itself because too many of us have too many things that we place before God. How many of us have something in our lives that's more important to us than is God? And that becomes a sin. Now, there's no doubt that sin abounds in our world, and our world is changing. Our world is changing significantly. If you don't believe so, I can remember when gas was 50 cents a gallon. And a pop was a dime. Some of you are probably going to say, I can remember when gas was a quarter. But I remember when it was 50 cents and you could buy a candy bar for a nickel. Now what's gas? $5 a gallon? Coke's $2. Candy bar's what, $1.50? Look how our world has changed. You don't think our world has changed? People are now shooting people. Kids are shooting kids. And let's be honest. How many single parent families do we have in our world in which we live? And I'm not making a judgment on anybody because one of my daughters is a single parent. The point is our world is changing, and those things that were the foundation of our world for years are now crumbling and falling apart. We live in a world of sin. We live in a world of sin. You know, it's interesting to me, when I was a kid growing up, they used to hand out Bibles at school. Now they hand out other things. And how many kids can actually define the concept of abstinence? You don't think our world is changing? Turn on the TV for a minute. Just turn on the TV. How many of you receive the channel MeTV? It shows the old-time TV shows on them. And turn that one on and watch Bugs Bunny and Roadrunner early in the morning. And then turn on the cartoon that you see in the evening called The Simpsons. You see, The Simpsons is an adult cartoon. I wouldn't let my grandchildren watch it at all. The point is, people, our world has changed, and sin is abounding, and sin is controlling our world, and has complete access to everything in which we live. How many of us have computers today? You know, it's interesting to me that computers provide a great deal of information, allow us to communicate with our world, and yet if we are not careful, sin, the computer can create such an addiction in our lives that it can destroy us. Point is that sin abounds. Sin is in control of our world. Sin has the rule over our lives. So let me ask you a simple question. What 750,000 miles long can wrap around our earth 30 times and grows by 20 miles a day? It's the number of people that do not know Jesus. It's the number of people that do not know Jesus. So how are you and I going to stand firm in the faith? How are you and I going to stand firm in the faith? Because this passage tells us that through the grace of God, God's love and mercy, through His Son Jesus Christ, we can stand firm in the faith. We can stand firm in the faith. And so in God's grace, love, and mercy, we can stand firm in the faith of Jesus Christ. And so we need to rest on Jesus' birth, His life, His perfect life, His ministry, His death for our sinfulness, and yes, His bodily resurrection. We need to put our faith in the living Christ at work in our lives. And so we need to place our hope in Jesus. We need to place our hope and our faith in Jesus. Hope is what leads us forward. Hope is what gives us strength. Hope is what brings change to our lives. You see, the church is what? The church is what is called to promote that hope, to provide that hope. The church is what is called to make a difference in the world, to promote that kind of hope within our lives or within our world. I think the problem is too many of us play at church. Too many of us play at church. We don't know what, or we don't want to know what the church is. What is the church? Well, 1 Peter tells us, thank you, as you come to him, the living stone rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like the living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So that's what the church is. We are living stones of Jesus Christ. We are the living stone. We are being called to be spiritual houses of Jesus Christ in the world in which we live. We are called to make a difference in the world, to be the stone. And so if you live as Christ and profess Christ as your world, you are the church. You are the living stone. You are the church of Jesus Christ. As we leave here today, we need to realize and accept that we are the living stones of Jesus Christ to the world, and that we are to live out our faith. And we may be the only Jesus that some people ever see. People, if we go out into the world and we don't live our faith, we're living a lie. If we go out in the world and profess one thing and live another way, we're living a lie. We are called to be examples of Christ in the world in which we live. You know, James 2 tells us. Can we have James 2 here? Thank you. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? Keep going. In the same way, faith by itself, it is not accompanied by actions, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Now, many people use this passage as a backdrop or a justification that their works will bring about their salvation for them. But the reality of it is this passage is saying that through our faith, we are to express it in the world in which we live. That we are to be examples of Christ in the world in which we live, and we're to show it through our actions, our works, and our deeds to those around us. And so our faith becomes a foundation, and it becomes our actions, our works become an expression of that faith. They become an expression of our faith. I'm reminded of an illustration of a, in 1988, Hurricane Gilbert destroyed most of the Louisiana coast. It was one of the worst hurricanes in that day. It was a terrible hurricane, and it destroyed shrimp boats and the Louisiana coastline. It was a mess. A reporter had a shrimper standing there being interviewed with the backdrop of all the destroyed shrimp boats and everything, and was interviewing the shrimper, and the shrimper says something profound, because the shrimper looks at the reporter and says, you know, as serious as that storm was, it's going to have stirred up the bottom of the ocean a great deal. And so when we're able to get our boats back out into the ocean, it will have stirred the shrimp up to the top of the water, and fishing should be pretty good then. You see, that man had hope. He had hope. Do we place our hope in Jesus? Do we place our living hope in Jesus? Hope should propel us forward. Hope should lead us forward. Hope should help us to see that we are to be the church to the world in which we live. And so the question becomes, what is the church and what is not the church? Well, I have an answer for you. Can I have those slides now? The church is not an ark for saving a select few. It is not a ferry boat to take effortless passengers to the shores of heaven. It's not a life insurance company with no obligations on policyholders except the payment of a small annual premium. Keep going, please. It's not a social set of welcoming certain people and excluding others from its fellowship. A Sunday pleasure club for the providing of pleasant occupation on the day of rest. The church is. Now, this is what the church is meant to be for you and me. It is a lifeboat for the rescue of sin-wrecked and perishing souls. It is a family in which love and service are expected from each member to each member. It is an organized community with constant activities and continual growth and development. It is a company of believers who have found the one way of life and obey the one Lord of life. A union of those who love for the benefit of those who suffer. A center of social worship in which the spiritual life of each is helped by the spiritual life of his fellow. The church is the representative and the body of Jesus Christ on the earth, reflecting its spirit and is controlled by his will. So do you see the difference between what the church is not and what the church is? You see, the church is called to be the people of Christ in the world. We are called to be the people of Christ, and we are called to stand firm in that faith. But too many of us play at church, don't we? Oh, by the way, do you know there's a difference between believing and faith? Have you ever understood that? There's a difference between believing and faith. Believing is an intellectual response. It's something you know. I believe this to be true. Faith is a response that goes to the soul, the heart, to the mind, to every aspect of our lives. It is a total and complete acceptance of who we are. And so when I say we play at church, we sing a few songs, we pass the plate, and we might actually stay awake in the sermon. I believe that. I don't put my faith in it, though, however. Right? You see, to say that we have faith, to live in faith, is to give our total lives to God. And to give every aspect of our lives. Now, here's what's interesting. You see, too many of us come to church as a way and have Christ in our lives as a way to God, for God to grant me this or God grant me that. But what really Jesus is asking us to do is to give ourselves, our hearts, our souls, our minds, and to go out and to make a difference in the world. To make a difference in the world. Hebrews tells us, can I have the first Hebrew passage, please? There it is. Not giving up on meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but exhorting one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And so the interesting word there is exhorting. For exhorting means to come alongside and inspire someone to know the truth. Isn't that what you and I are called to do? To come along someone's life and inspire them to know the truth of Jesus Christ. Isn't that what we are called to do? So how do we stand firm? Well, I think first of all, we need to seek to give our lives to Jesus and give up on our sinful ways. To eliminate those things from our lives that separate us from God. It causes us to get caught up in our selfish desires. It call us to get caught up in our own greedy, selfish nature. And then we are called to follow the teachings of Jesus Christ. We are called to follow the teachings of, and we have a great teacher, people. We have a great teacher. Look at what Hebrews says, the second Hebrew passage. Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." So he understands what we are going through, and he wants us to pattern our lives after Christ. He wants us to pattern our lives after him, so that you and I can overcome our sinful nature. You see, Jesus calls us to be obedient, to live a godly life, and to follow God's commands. And if we are willing to do that, we can make a difference in the world in which we live. We can take up the cross. We can stand firm in the faith and live for Christ Jesus. Let us pray. Oh, gracious and holy God, we thank you for this time that we have had together. We pray that our hearts and our minds might be open to your presence and to your power. Lead and guide us, oh, gracious God, that we might be your faithful followers today and every day. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Reverend Davis. And now let's stand for our closing song.
Following the benediction, there will be a short video regarding the upcoming mission trip. I would invite you to be seated immediately following the benediction. Let us pray. Oh, gracious, holy God, may we go forth in your name. May we go forth in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who makes a difference within our lives and within our hearts and our souls. Touch us, Lord, as we go out in the world, that we might be examples for you this day. Amen. Please be seated.